In Abeokuta, a teenager takes his girlfriend out on a date. Sofiat dresses up carefully. She's a fashion designer after all. She imagines a romantic evening. The teenager takes her home, he makes love to her, and then he cuts off her head. With the help of three other friends, none of them over 20, they boil Sofiat's head in a pot so that with a magic mixture of evil and blood, boys who have not worked for millions might become millionaires. In Joss, another 20-year-old boy lures his girlfriend Jennifer, a 300-level student at a university, to a hotel room. He ritually murders her, orders room service, and uses the fork to pluck out her eyes. In Benin, Owa, an ambitious young undergraduate goes to her small church to study. It's a quiet and empty place at night. She normally studies here to improve her grades. A young man approaches her, distracts her with conversation so that from behind two other boys can attack her. She's raped and ritually murdered for a female client. Every day, hundreds of innocents lose their lives to these horrendous murders that violate intimate and sacred relationships in our society for so-called money-making rituals. And not just romantic relationships either. A mother and her 32-year-old son conspired and killed their own younger son and brother to get rich quick. Another young man invites his mother to his flat in Owerri. She arrives bearing fruit for her much-loved son. He lets her in, locks the door, and approaches her with a knife. No, he has not come to slice the pineapple. He stabs again and again his own mother for money. Mothers kill sons, and sons kill mothers. Brothers kill brothers for money. Society grows suspicious. The social trust deficit grows. Relationships are poisoned. The clergy is not left out. In Oshun, a young girl was invited to service by church members, but they were not interested in her eternal soul. They killed her and buried her body parts under the altar with their pastor for money. In Zaria, neighbors kidnapped 8-year-old Asmao, collected a 3 million naira ransom, and murdered her. In Kano, a school owner, unsatisfied with the school fees from his students, kidnaps one of them, the 5-year-old Hanifa. He visited the parents to commiserate, to throw them off the scent, all the while demanding ransom behind their backs. He collected the money, killed the girl with rat poison, then he buries her in a shallow grave. Her own teacher. These are fundamentally law and other problems. But our laws are currently in a state of disorder. Unfortunately, this is not even a Nigerian problem. Across Africa, it's the same. Across the 16-member SADC, the Southern African Development Community, muti murders or ritual killings are rife. Victims are often having their organs harvested while they are still alive. From Malawi to Liberia, from Zimbabwe across to Tanzania, hundreds of thousands of albinos have been murdered and mutilated with their bodies mined for money and power rituals. This atavism is not new. The cult of blood money is as old as our rivers, sadly. But there's a new meanness in the hearts of our societies, and it is growing to epidemic proportions. And everywhere you turn, you can see our despair as our youth that should midwife our glorious new future now qualify for our demonic first 11. You can feel our horror as a people. Yet there is something superficial, even disingenuous, about our collective horror over these ritual murders for money. Because although there are tears in our eyes, there is also blood on our hands. If as a society we were truly horrified at the murder of innocents, it would be a thoroughgoing revulsion, not just at the murders of teenage girls and boys and men and women, but also at the murderers themselves. When a teenager with no visible source of income comes courting in a limousine, clearly well beyond his means, He should receive derision. He should be shown the door. But no, he receives the hands of our daughters in marriage. We, the public, populate the ranks of the ritual murderers by guaranteeing ill-gotten wealth, our embrace, our admiration, once the demons are dressed in Versace and roll up in Rolls Royces to spray dollars at our parties. To fawn over lifestyle pictures of known frauds is to piss on the graves of their victims. Our evil genius as a society is our ability to separate the sordid sources of wealth from the flashy uwambes of their ostentatious display. But we cannot approbate and reprobate. We must own this inversion of our societal values and do something about it. Otherwise, we are hypocritical vampires complaining about the bloodletting outside the bar and sipping delicately from cocktail glasses brimming with blood. The original ritual killers in our society are our political elite, whose ritual murders are conducted in plain sight on a wholesale basis, so that by a mixture of blood and evil, men who have not worked for billions might become billionaires. The slaughter slabs of our elite are in budget rooms where pension funds and funds for hospitals, for orphanages, for schools and roads are routinely embezzled. Death wears a bow tie, attends Senate committee meetings, sweeps his machete, killing pensioners right there on their queue for their embezzled pensions, slaughtering nursing mothers in their drugless hospitals, starving orphans, and harvesting body parts from debt traps disguised as roads. Students are expelled from schools to join Nigeria's 10 million strong army of the world's largest population of out-of-school children, also known as the Boko Haram Recruitment Agency. Although they both lack legitimate sources of income, our Yahoo youth accumulate limos the way our political elite accumulate bullion vans. While each limo of the young demons represent a slaughtered soul and devastated family, each of those vans represent thousands of lives and destinies. Nigeria's life expectancy, for instance, is currently the fourth lowest in the entire world. At 55 years, it is 18 years below the world average of 73 years. So on average, 200 million Nigerians have been robbed of 18 years of life by kleptocratic rulers. Those 18 years of life are the blood sacrifice of the average Nigerian to the ravenous bloodlust of our political elite and their enablers. We are justly horrified at the ritual killings of our youth. But where is our outrage at our political elite who have devastated the values of our society as well as the education and economic prospects of our youth? There is none. Treasury thieves and their apologists and children who should hide their faces in shame, they flaunt golf courses and private jets on social media. But at what cost in human blood? Those ill-gotten luxury cars preening on Instagram have an opportunity cost. It is the lives and futures and destinies of compatriots. Where is our outrage? There is none. Instead, surrounding each political serial murderer is a cult of whitewashers who cheer them onto the 2023 electoral cycle of ritual murder. The evil genius of our leaders is their ability to de-link their glamorous lifestyle from the corpses of the premature dead on our streets, on our homes, and our hospitals nationwide. We must relink them. That ill-gotten house in Dubai is 1,000 internally displaced persons starving to death. Only a ritual killer can sleep there soundly at night. It is time to identify those root causes of our anathema, to root them out with our national sustained outrage. The cycle of crocodile tears for victims and fawning over victimizers, it must end. We cannot fraternize with drug barons while kicking out at drug peddlers. We cannot use our four-yearly electoral rituals to elect mass murderers into office. We must audit our role in the ritual murders in our society and end their travesty now. Unfortunately, simply rejecting past political leaders and electing new ones, it won't save us. We are too far gone. Any saint that finds themselves in office is likely compromised by the process, the journey of getting there. Nigerian elections cost billions. Much of that money goes into bribes to influence voters and officials and pervert the course of democracy. The last presidential elections, for instance, had over 70 candidates. But apart from the candidates of the two big parties, none of the others achieved anywhere up to half of a percentage of the 28 million votes cast. So, unless you're a godfather yourself, it's almost impossible to win elections in Nigeria as things stand without being indebted to godfathers. And they will secure the loyalty of their proteges by various means, including ritual oath takings. Remember Okija? So it means that whoever emerges victorious in Nigerian politics is already permanently indebted to godfathers who own the machinery of the successful parties. That indebtedness is paid by raping the public treasury. White elephant projects are budgeted for and dirty loans are taken out for no other reason but for the settlement of paymasters. So if I invest $1 billion in electing a president, I will get contracts worth billions in compensation. And even if I decide not to execute them, it doesn't matter so long as my poodle remains in government. So the campaign promises of a candidate, his supposed integrity, which got him elected, are no match for the real politics of our so-called democracy. Those who try to break with their godfathers are either impeached by the godfathers' stooges in the legislature, or they rape the treasury to build their own political machine. In either case, the public is the loser. We also can't simply build better institutions. Like state capture, institution capture is real. So even if we hire a bad president, simply an incompetent president, that may condemn the country for 4 years, but a bad president can hire idiots into the career management track of government institutions, which will write them off for another generation. There are also corporate godfathers in Nigeria, companies that invest billions in the election of candidates across the political spectrum, to guarantee that whichever way the political wind blows, their minions are hired to regulate them, and their monopolies or oligopolies continue to thrive at the expense of the public interest. So we need a more systemic approach to defending both our public service and our public treasury. The solution is to make it impossible for the public treasury and public powers to be abused or to be used for anything other than the public interest. We must introduce a law in Nigeria that punishes the abuse of office over a threshold of, say, ₦1 million by total assets forfeiture in the case of individuals and liquidation in the case of private companies. This eliminates godfathers from the political spectrum of Nigeria, both in the realm of funding and in the realm of puppeteering public officials. And that crashes the cost of elections. Because anyone who invests billions in politics with the hope of getting it back in corrupt contracts risks losing everything. It will also eliminate the murderers who currently fill our political offices, whose only purpose is to destroy the lives and destinies of Nigerians by raping the treasury. By eliminating the carpetbaggers from the corridors of power, the door is open for the visionaries that Nigeria really needs, who come into office with neither money bags nor debts to pay, but with only their abilities and their visions for the country. The game plan for this law is set out clearly at www.bribecode.org. Please support it. The other provisions of the bribe code, such as the whistleblower's reward and the universal prosecution powers, these guarantee that this is not just another paper tiger. Once enacted, it is a law that will be enforced. Please go to bribecode.org, sign the petition, and send the law to your legislator, and campaign for it. When we have enthroned a civic-oriented and accountable leadership, sanity will filter through our societies. Monies budgeted for health and education, for welfare, for the youth, for infrastructure, for law and order, it will get to the grassroots. Only then can we reboot our law and order so that it starts cleaning from the top down. Only then can we finally heal our society right down to the grassroots and save the future Sofiats and Hanifas and Uwas and Jennifers from the demons in our midst. Thank you for your time. Bless my day, O my God, and let not my rivals overtake me. When I retire, let them hire me again. When I die, let my daughter take my place. Let my enemies raise their hands and pray.
Yes, sir. Master. May you live
long, sir. Blind my people, Lord. Make their brains come beef. In Jesus' mighty name, make them fools. When they catch me stealing and I shout church or tribalism, let them scatter. Let them fight themselves. Let my victims sing.
Yes, sir, Master. We believe in you, sir.
Make them deaf, O God. Make my people deaf. Though the judges call me thief day and night, let my people hail me chief day and night.
That's right.
Let the hungry, jobless fools dance for me. Even as I sell their land, let them sing.
Yes, sir, Master. We believe in you, sir.
For my white collar sins, forgive me, O Lord. In the blood of Jesus, rinse my billion-dollar double invoice petrochemical sins. Holy Ghost fire, shield my pot of soup. Keep my houseboys honest. Make them sing.
Yes, sir, Master. Yes, sir.
Fill my constituency with drunks, O Lord. Give me idiots whose price is beer and pepper soup. Give me easy journalists and PhDs whose back is silenced by my bone. Give these fools their daily booze. Let them sing.
Yes, sir, Master. We live long, sir.
Must you try my fate, O God? Then send me talkers, not doers. You know my strength is small. Send me Facebook fiends and Twitter twits whose rage ejaculates safely on their page. Street parties, not matches. Let them dance and sing.
Yes, sir, Master. We live long, sir.
Make them long-suffering, like zebu cows, O Lord. Though I milk them dry, though I drive them hard, though I lead them to the second civil war, let the Mughals follow. Let them vote like cows. And let them sing in churches, mosques, and shrines.
Yes, sir, Master. We live long, sir.
And for all my foes, the judge erect, the man unreached, all these hungry paupers scheming hard for my seat, may they meet Kudirat's bullet, may they break and quench, sack and disgrace them until they sing.
Yes, sir, Master, may you live long, sir.
In the name of Jesus, send me prophets, send me imams and shamans too, and I will send them tithes to turn the hungry prayers of their flock to you, to turn their curses on the poor devil, and to me to sing.
Yes, sir, Master, may you live long, sir.
Lord of Jesus, block the curse of the blood of innocent dead, blood from roads I did not fix, hospitals I did not stock. And when I come weeping to the victims' wakekeeping, let them not stone me. Instead, let them sing.
Yes, sir, Master, may you live long, sir.
The table is broken. The table is broken.